What is up, engine heads? Today we're talking about this. A tiny, cute little miniature running 45 degree V-twin engine. We're going to unbox it, we're going to review it, we're going to try and start it up. And then at the end of the video, we'll be talking a bit about why different V-twin motorcycle engines choose different degrees between their two cylinders. So, let's get started. When it comes to the packaging of the engine, everything looks good and the engine is protected pretty well. The only thing that might be at risk from rough handling are the exhaust tubes, which are placed into the bubble wrap next to the box. The engine itself is well protected and comes inside this neat little unbranded black box. When it comes to the exterior appearances of the engine, I have to say that everything looks absolutely perfect and well made. The machining is without fault and I really can't find anything obvious to complain about when it comes to the fit and finish of this little thing. Inside the box we can also find some O-rings of unknown purpose, some electrical connectors, and this shaft which is used for starting the engine. Inside is also our CDI box which provides the ignition for the engine. At the back of the box lid you can find the instructions. Unfortunately, the instructions are almost useless and don't explain any of the basics, so you have to figure out pretty much everything yourself. Now the engine comes without a stand and you have to make some sort of stand for it. There are four mounting holes made on the engine and they are designed for M3 bolts. I made a simple stand by installing the bolts into the engine and applying some paint onto the bolt heads and then placed the engine on my wooden stand surface to leave paint marks that correspond to the bolt locations. I then drilled the holes and countersunk them so the bolts wouldn't stick out from the stand bottom. I also made some spacers by measuring the bolts and cutting some 4mm pipe to size. Finally, I installed the bolts and the spacers and bolted the engine down. Unfortunately, only two of the four mounting holes have threads cut into them for some reason. But the aluminum is soft enough so the bolt can actually make a thread for itself if you force it a bit. Of course, if you want to do things properly, I suggest cutting a thread into the two holes yourself. Once the engine was mounted, it was time to provide a source of electrical energy for the ignition. I did this with a set of six AA batteries which I connected to the little connector that comes in the kit. The connector is then connected to the CDI ignition box, and the box is connected to the sensor on the engine. The ignition also needs to be grounded to the engine, and fortunately a bolt and a ground location is already provided. Unfortunately, the bolt is too long and/or the thread isn't deep enough, so the connector hangs loose, as you can see here, so I added some spacers to get proper grounding. Once that is done, the final electrical connection is obviously to the spark plugs. When you have connected everything, you can verify that the ignition is working by turning the engine over by hand and watching and/or listening for a spark. The camera probably can't capture this, but you can actually hear a tiny click and even see a tiny spark if you watch closely. Interestingly enough, the engine actually rotates counterclockwise. Once the ignition is verified to work, the last thing we need to do is to provide fuel. The instructions actually call for Zippo fuel mixed together with two-stroke oil at a ratio of 25:1. The fuel connection is at the bottom of the carburetor. Unfortunately, the position and orientation of the fitting makes it very difficult to install a hose, and I think an L-shaped fitting or something else would have been a much better idea here. Now we can install the exhaust tubes. Now in my case, no matter how much I tightened the nut, the exhaust tube would still kind of feel loose and it would wiggle around. I even tried installing the little O-ring underneath the nut to maybe get it to stay put, but unfortunately it didn't work and the exhaust tubes were loose no matter what I did. Once everything is in, we can attempt our first start. We first have to prime the engine by blocking off the carb intake with our hand and rotating the engine by hand 3 to 4 times. Once this is done, we install our shaft into a handheld drill. Again, don't forget, the engine actually turns counterclockwise. My first start was a failure, as you can see, and there were no signs of life from the engine. There is nothing in the instructions or on the plug wires or in the CDI box that tells you which wire goes onto which spark plug, so I tried switching them. Fortunately, that worked and the engine started right up. This was genuinely my first start and I got the engine started within 15 minutes from taking it out of the box. So I have to say it's extremely impressive how easily it started. It required virtually zero troubleshooting. Once you do get it started, you can try adjusting the idle by turning the screw at the back of the carburetor to get a better, more stable, lower RPM idle. Overall, the feel, sound and vibrations coming from the engine are extremely impressive. It sounds incredibly similar to an actual motorcycle engine, and hearing it in person is a really special sensation. So I have to say that they really nailed that part, and this is without a doubt a truly impressive gift for someone into engines or motorcycles, especially Harleys or cruiser bikes in general. Overall, I think this is a really cool product that just needs a bit of polishing to get it right. When it comes to the pros, I have to say that it has an exceptional look, fit and finish. The sound is amazing and the engine is very easy to start and doesn't require any sort of troubleshooting, which often isn't the case when it comes to these miniature engines. When it comes to the cons, I have to say that the instructions are poor. This can be fixed really easily with some basic stuff that you can put in instructions and maybe pay someone for an actual proper translation. And something else that definitely needs to be improved is the attention to detail. All of these are minor things that are easy to fix, and fixing them would lead to a product where you really wouldn't have anything to complain about. Now let's use this engine as an example for some theoretical discussion, and let's talk about the angle of the V in V-twin engines. As you can see, our miniature engine is clearly trying to mimic the Harley-Davidson Panhead engine, and like almost all Harley-Davidson engines since 1909, it has a 45 degree angle between the two cylinders. So which angle between the cylinders is best? 45, 90, 60, or maybe something in between? In reality, there is no such thing as the best or perfect angle for a V-twin engine. We only have different compromises for different applications. For example, a 90 degree V-twin like those we see in Ducati motorcycles makes it possible to achieve perfect primary balance with the use of a crankshaft counterweight. A crankshaft counterweight can't balance out the mass of the piston in a single cylinder engine. When the piston is at top dead center, the crankshaft counterweight can indeed balance it out. But when the engine rotates to 90 degrees, the piston and the counterweight point in different directions and thus can't balance each other out. But in a 90 degree V-twin, the crankshaft counterweight can balance out both pistons. When piston of cylinder 1 is at TDC, it's balanced out by the crankshaft counterweight. When the engine rotates 90 degrees, the crankshaft counterweight can now balance out the other piston and connecting rod assembly. The result is dramatically reduced vibrations and a smooth running engine. Now, if we observe the 45 degree V-twin engine, we can see that the crankshaft counterweight cannot fully balance out the piston masses like it can do in the 90 degree V-twin. Due to the more narrow angle between the cylinders, the counterweight can only partially balance out the masses of the pistons and the conrods, leading to an imperfect primary balance. But the 45 degree V-twin has an advantage when it comes to its firing interval, which goes like this. We fire a cylinder, rotate 315 degrees, fire the other cylinder, rotate 405 degrees, fire the first cylinder again, and so on. The firing interval is 315, 405, 315, 405. Things are different in the 90 degree V-twin. We fire a cylinder, rotate 270 degrees, fire the other cylinder, rotate 450 degrees, fire the first cylinder again, and so on. The resulting firing interval is 270, 450, 270, 450. As you can see, both firing intervals are uneven, but the more narrow angle between the cylinders of the 45 degree V-twin results in a firing interval that is less uneven. The 45 degree engine also has the benefit of being more compact, which means that it's easier to fit into the frame than a 90 degree engine, which sometimes requires increasing the wheelbase length to accommodate it. On the other hand, the larger angle of the 90 degree V means that there's more space for intake and carburetors or fuel injection, and better cooling, as the cylinder in front does not obstruct the cylinder in the back as much as in the 45 degree V. On the other hand, the 90 degree angle leads to a more problematic secondary engine balance, but that and much more will be covered in one of my future videos on V-twin engine balance, which will dive much deeper into the subject. So that's pretty much it for now and for today. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, I'll be seeing you soon with more fun and useful stuff on the D4A channel.